أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على أشرف الأنبياء وحبيب الله العالمين أبي القاسم محمد وعلى بيته الطيبين الطاهرين لا سيما مولانا وسيدي صاحب الأصل والزمان روحي وأرواح العالمين له الفداء وأجل الله تعالى فرجه الشريف ولعنة دائمة على أعدائهم ومنكر فضائلهم إلى لعننا قيام يوم الدين. We continue on in our commentary review of chapter number 68, Surat Al-Qalam. And today in our third discussion, we'll be looking at two specific verses, verses number 2 and number 3. As you recall from our previous discussion, we had just looked at the initial verse and a bit about the concept of these disjointed letters that Allah brings in the fourth in the Quran, and also about the role of the pen, about media, about the role of the pen, both metaphorical and their literal pen, in terms of the way that media works in the day and age that we live in today. Today we focus our attention on what Allah is referring to the Prophet about. And obviously we know that in many of the verses of the Quran, Rasulullah was the direct one who's being spoken to. Many times Allah would speak about previous nations, but sometimes Allah speaks directly to the Prophet or speaks directly about the Prophet. This is one sort of those passages where Allah is speaking directly to Rasulullah. And as we see in the verse, Allah says in verse number 2, He says, مَا أَنْتَ بِنِعْمَةِ رَبِّكَ بِمَجْنُونَ, that you, O Muhammad, by the grace of your Lord, are not insane. You haven't gone mad. وَإِنَّ لَكَ لَأَجْرًا غَيْرَ مَمْنُونَ, and indeed you most surely will have a reward which will never be cut off. So one of the things that we see in the time of our Prophet, obviously, but all of the Prophets that have been sent that are mentioned in the Quran, and one of the things that we see amongst humanity on a whole is this, belief or this action that people do of false accusations. In this verse of the Quran, the people are accusing Rasulullah of being a madman, of being Majnoon. And this is not something new. When we look in the Quran, we see that many of the prophets of Allah have been misaligned like this. They've been attacked. They have had their character questioned within the society. And so the first thing I want to look at are some of these accusations that people level against Rasulullah and why this happens. As I mentioned, that when we look in the Quran, many of the prophets of Allah, in fact, we have a belief that every single prophet of Allah in one form or another, and not even only the prophets of Allah, but even other noble men and women mentioned in the Quran, that they've all been mistreated, abused, they have been insulted, they've been mocked in one form or another. You look in the Quran, beginning with Prophet Nuh alayhi salam, Prophet Noah, and when the Quran speaks about Nabi Nuh and the way that people would deal with him, the Quran tells us in chapter of Surah Nuh, that the people would actually put their fingers in their ears and take their clothes and cover over themselves to try to keep away from Prophet Noah and his message. Many of the prophets of the Quran, as we know, were insulted and mocked in this way. The Quran tells us many of the prophets were outright killed, actually. And because of that fact, that we see that they were bringing a message of reformation to society. And for many people, they didn't want to reform themselves. And when a person doesn't want to reform themselves, what is the best thing to do is to claim that that reformer, that person who's bringing this change about in their community, in the society, that this guy is just crazy, he's gone insane, he doesn't know what he's talking about. And so this is a form that has happened within the history. And we know that when it wouldn't, when people would not, when those accusations weren't enough, then obviously they were resorted to even killing the prophets of Allah. This happened with the prophets. This also happened with, for example, Maryam alayha salam, the mother of Nabi Isa, where they accused her falsely of, for example, having illicit relationships. How could she bring a child into the world without a husband? And so these accusations are nothing new. They have happened to the best of people, to the prophets of Allah. And obviously they happen even in our own day-to-day age. Many times you just have to, watch social media or, go and listen to conversations happening in the centers. And people will have a problem with a certain marja taqlid, for example. And we'll begin to point fingers at them. We'll say, well, he lives in another country. What does he know? He has no idea how difficult it is life in the West for him to pass fatwas of, you know, fasting, long hours, or any of these things. And so we begin, even ourselves, we begin to launch accusations even against our maraja, that how can they know certain things? How can they guide us when they're so far removed from our communities? Again, this is not something new. When we look in the Quran, there are at least three different ways that people would attack the prophets of God, most specifically our prophet. In one collection of verses, we see that people refer to the prophets and Rasulullah as a magician and being insane. So chapter 51, verse number 52, they say that, thus there did not come to those before them a messenger, except they said that he is a magician or a madman. They called them magicians because they were doing things that didn't seem possible. You know, how can you convert people? How can you change people's outlook on the world, how they deal with other people in society, merely by verses in a book? Many of those people at the time of Rasulullah, they were perplexed that this is a man who is not bringing a miracle, for example, like Nabi Musa had brought, but he was bringing words on paper, and these words were changing the society. And so people say, well, this guy must be a magician. He must be tricking the people, because you can't just change people by words. They would also say he's a madman. You know, again, they were trying to break the character of the prophet, trying to engage in what we call character assassination. And I'll look at that very briefly, but these are two of the examples. In another verse of the Quran in chapter 37, verse number 36, they say, and to say, what, shall we give up all of our gods for the sake of a mad poet? So they called Rasulullah a poet. They said this book he is bringing, the Quran, is a book of poetry. And yes, to an extent, the style of the Quran is a rhythmic style. There's no doubt about it. When you listen to Quran being recited with correct tajweed, with correct pronunciation in the tarteel style of recitation, it definitely sounds like poetry. But we realize that the Quran, and Allah tells us this in Surah Yasin, a chapter that we recite every Thursday, Allah tells us that وَمَا أَلَّمْنَاهُ شِعْرَ وَمَا يَنْبَغِيرَ وَمَا يَنْبَغِيلَ, that we have not taught him poetry, nor does it behoove the prophet to be referred to as a poet or to bring poetry. So people looked at the Quran, and because it had a rhythmic style, it had a pattern to it when you recite it, they said this prophet is a poet, and this book is a book of poetry. But we realize that even though the Quran has that aspect, but poetry is quite different than the Quran. You know, poetry in most cases is about fantasy world, right? If you read poems, even by poets in the Muslim world or even non-Muslim poets, and you read what they write about, their poetry is more or less about a fantasy world. It's about relationships. It's about things that never happened. It's about things that they wish they have done, but they never were able to attain it in their life. And so poetry is quite different. There's usually, maybe there is a message, maybe there's some moral to the poem, to the story. But the Quran can never be called a book of poetry. Allah himself declares this in the Quran, that the Quran is not poetry in the traditional sense of that word, nor is Rasulullah a poet. But again, people do this. People have done this over the past, you know, the time of Rasulullah for his 23 years. And since then, up until today, people level such accusations, mostly because of the fact that they don't want to believe. And what better way to not want to, or not to, you know, to not believe in something or somebody than accusing them of certain things? Because when you put a label on somebody, you say, this guy's crazy, he's insane, he's a madman. Now you discount not only him, but you discount what that person is bringing, the message. When you say this person is a magician, why follow him? You're obviously trying to, you know, box him in something so that you don't follow him, and you try to encourage people not to follow that individual. And so one of the things that humanity has done throughout the years is to put
prophets of God, put the men and women of God into these sorts of categories to engage in character assassination. Now this term, what does it mean, character assassination? It's defined as a deliberate and a sustained process that destroys the credibility and reputation of a person, an institution, a social group, or a nation. Again, and this is something which has not only been at the time of Rasulullah, but even continues till today. We see it happening to our religious leaders. We see it happening to even people in the community. You don't like somebody because of who they are, because they're bringing about, let's say, change, because they're doing things in a different way. And we want to, again, put labels upon them, try to destroy their reputation in the community, in the society. The definition goes on to say that agents of character assassinations employ a mix of open and covert methods to achieve their goals, such as raising false accusations. This is exactly what they did to the prophets. You're a madman, you're crazy, you're insane, you're a poet, you're a magician. All of these false accusations were done then, and even in today's day and age, people use this same tactic. Also, people would use the act of planting and fostering rumors. Right? Again, this is also done at the time of the prophets. They would do that, for example, to Maryam alayhi salam, the mother of Nabi Isa. They accused her. They put rumors in society that she was not a chaste woman. That way they could deflect from Nabi Isa and his message. People did this to Imam Hassan alayhi salam. They accused him of many very gross and indecent things. Why? To keep him away. And all of the noble men of women and of the Quran and of history have had this happen to them, this act of false rumors, and also of manipulating information. And so all of these things are done with that sole aim and purpose of ensuring that people don't follow the messenger and the message that that person is going to bring. So just a few points from this brief review. What happens when all of this goes on, when character assassination takes place, when people call the prophets Majnoon, insane, when they say that they're magicians, when they say that they're, you know, all of these things? One is that they try to have them be rejected by their community, by their family, by the society. And again, when we study the life of Rasulullah in particular, because this verse is directly speaking to him and people who were accusing him, that people wanted to have Rasulullah be rejected by the entire society. The people of Mecca, when they offered Rasulullah all of the riches that they had, when they said, we'll give you all of the most beautiful women of the Arabian Peninsula, you just stop giving this message. You just stop propagating the religion of Islam. And he had that very famous statement that he told Hazrat Abu Talib, peace be upon him, oh, my uncle, that if they were to put the sun in my right hand and the moon in my left, meaning that if they were to give me the entire universe, that I would never stop in this message until I am successful or Allah takes my life on this path. But their whole goal was to ensure that he would be rejected by the society, that the companions, the friends around the Prophet would eventually wanted to reject, that they would try to get them to reject him. But we know when we study history that all of these accusations, although they may have had a minimal impact, but the fact remains that today that there are 1.8 billion Muslims on the earth. And if you figure that 1400 years ago, it starts with one man in Mecca, in a dry desert land, and that after 1400 years, the religion has progressed to how it is today, that one in every four people on earth is a Muslim. We realize that all of those attacks against the Messenger of Allah, the taunts, the mocking of him, calling him names, all of these have obviously not been successful. But we see that it continues even in today's day and age. They still try to use these tactics against the religion of Islam and Rasulullah. However, we do know that, as we mentioned, that sometimes these things are difficult to reverse or rectify. And that's why even in Islam, we're always told, be careful what you speak. Don't talk about other people. We know the sin about backbiting, how grievous it is. And keep in mind that backbiting isn't that you are lying about somebody. When I say something, or when somebody talks about somebody in terms of backbiting, you're actually speaking a truth about that person. So if it's such a problem to speak the truth about somebody that they would not like for you to repeat about them, imagine how much of a sin it can be if you make up stories about somebody. If you falsely accuse somebody innocent of doing something or being somebody that they're not. So it's a difficult thing to rectify. It's a difficult thing to go and change in the society. Once you post it on the internet and you accuse somebody of something that they haven't done, or you spread a rumor in a community, it's almost impossible to take those words back and to change what you've done or what you've said about an individual. And obviously, when we look at this issue of these accusations and character assassination, the damage that can be sustained, it lasts a lifetime, right? Even if you are able to vindicate the person and they're found to be innocent, but still that stigma will be on that person until the day they die, even though people may realize that it's not true what was said about them, but still that stigma will be on there. And people will still somehow remember that person as how they were attacked in the mainstream society. And obviously for those who are, you know, very famous personalities, long after they die, after they leave this world, those accusations remain with them. You know, they basically are never absolved. They're within the society, they're never absolved all those words or those statements against that individual. The second point that we end with this for tonight is in the third verse, where Allah says that indeed you, the Prophet, will have a reward which is never ending. One of the ways that Allah consoled Rasulullah is after he says that, you know, you are not insane, you are not a crazy man, you're not a lunatic, is that Allah says that you will indeed have a reward which will never be cut off. This is a blessing from Allah. This is one of the things that Allah gave to Rasulullah. That you are being, you know, insulted in society, people will mock you, people will call you names, people will insult you. But rest assured that your reward with me will never end. It will be a continuous, perpetual reward. It's something for us to also think about. When we are in those situations where maybe we have been attacked, where we have been, you know, aligned in the society, that if we're able to deal with that level of accusation against us, that the rewards of Allah are also very much there for you and I. And when Allah speaks about rewards, in that verse he says, your rewards will never be cut off. But we have five other ways, or five ways that Allah describes his rewards in the Quran. For example, in Surah number 11, Surah Ibrahim, Allah talks about ajrun kabir. Allah says his rewards are large. You know, with Allah, even in Dua Iftitah, we just read that no matter how much Allah gives, his treasures never stop. Allah can give the world and all that contains in the world to each and every single human being. But yet Allah would never decrease in what he has with him. So his rewards are large. Also Allah uses the adjective in Surah number 3, Surah Al-Imran, where he says, Ajrun Azim, that they're a great reward. Right? Whatever Allah gives is great. Right? We always, you know, sometimes we look at the glass as being half empty, rather than the glass being half full. When Allah gives us, even if Allah gives us a very little bit, we have to realize the worth of that blessing of Allah. Allah gives the best to us. It's just sometimes that we look at that blessing in the incorrect way, and we, you know, maybe ask Allah, we demand sometimes from Allah more, not realizing that what He's given us is indeed a great reward. Allah also in chapter 36, he talks about ajrun kareem, this honorable reward, an honorable gift. We see also chapter 41, Allah talks about ajrun ghayru mamnoon, as we see in this verse, an endless reward. And also ajrun hasana, a very good reward, a very good return that Allah gives. So Allah uses all of these different adjectives to describe the returns, the rewards, what He recompenses with. And without a doubt, when Allah talks about His rewards as being such, there can be no doubt that they are exactly as He describes them to be. Let me end with two last points that we should reflect upon in this in these two verses. One is that the infallibility, this ismat that the messenger has, the protection which has been afforded by Allah to the prophets, is a great blessing. And we'll reflect on this a bit more tomorrow. that the prophets of Allah being ma'soom, being infallible, they don't make mistakes. They don't make lapses of judgment. They don't insult people. They don't make fun of people. This is actually a blessing that Allah has given to them. It is a form of protection that Allah has granted to certain individuals. And it is for a very specific reason, which inshallah in our next discussion we'll look at the next verse, because Allah addresses this topic. But it's something to keep in mind and to think about, that why would Allah give these prophets this level of protection from sin? Why are they of impeccable character to the point where even we know that Rasulullah, 40 years of his initial life, he developed such a quality that people call him the trustworthy and the truthful. Right? This is something that we need to think about and reflect, that why or how do these great men and women of Allah develop such a personality and repertoire within the society that people cannot point a finger at them of being people who are of ill repute or of a bad character. And last but not least that we should think about is that in the return for the difficulties that people sometimes face, the prophets obviously, but even us included, lies a great reward with Allah. Right? We face difficulties in life, but keep in mind that Rasulullah has a hadith where he says that no prophet was ever insulted, mocked, harassed as bad as I was. Right? This is a hadith from Rasulullah where he's been quoted as saying that no prophet before me has been harassed as much as I have. And you look in the Quran about Nabi Musa, how people attacked him. Nabi Isa, how they almost tried to kill him. Nabi Yahya, where they actually did kill him and they decapitated him. And Rasulullah says, after all of these prophets, he says, still he is the one who had faced the most oppression, the most attacks against himself. Physically, definitely, but also at a level of character assassination. But the outcome is that when we face those difficulties and we are able to bear them and we're able to maintain our composure, that the reward with Allah is great, it is never ending, it is a magnanimous reward that Allah has for each and every one of us. We close in this day of month of Ramadan and we ask Allah to accept our acts of worship that we have performed in these last 6 days. We ask Allah to give us the ability to continue to fast in the remainder of this month of Ramadan, that we're able to dedicate time to the reading and reflection and contemplation on the Quran. And we ask Allah to accept all of the supplications that we make in this blessed month, and that we are able to enter into Laylatul Qadr with the ability to ask istighfar, to ask forgiveness for our sins, and that we're able to be absolved of all of our sins as we make our way towards the day of Eid. رَبَّنَا تَقَبَّلْ مِنَّا إِنَّكَ أَنْتَ السَّمِيعُ الْعَلِيمُ. Let us close by remembering all of the deceased from our community, our family, our friends, the ulama, the shuhada who have left this world, with a surah mubarakatul fatiha, but before that, one salawat upon Muhammad wa Ali Muhammad. Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad. Bismillah ar-Rahman.